July 19th, 2020. Glad you're all here. Let's open with a word of prayer and ask God's blessing on our time together. Father in heaven, we're here this morning because you have told us to meet together. To meet together to worship you in song, from your word, in our fellowship, through everything we do. So we ask for your blessing on our time together. May your Holy Spirit help us in our hearts and minds to focus on what is truly important, and that is you, O Lord. So bless us this morning. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Well, if you'll notice in your bulletin, there's a huge list of announcements. But we do have one thing to show, and that is a...
three bullets. Oh,
by the way, are there any announcements that need to be made that aren't in the bulletin? No? Okay. Oh, yes.
Just let everybody know, we have sold our house, and there's a good chance that the house we have made an offer on will be ours in 3 weeks. And so we're looking at moving this next month.
Okay.
And praise God for answering that prayer.
The Hamovitzes are praising God that their house is in the process of being sold. It's not been finalized yet.
Everything's been approved. We're just waiting for the closing date at the end of the month.
Okay, so everything's being approved. They're just waiting for the closing date.
And then we have a house in Springfield that we need.
And then they have a house in Springfield that they're going to move to. So they'll be moving this next month. So praise God for that. We have a video from Micah for this morning, so if we could roll that.
Good morning, Muslim Baptist. So excited to be coming there. It's just 2 weeks from today, and it's hard to think about without smiling. So it's just bring smiles to our faces, knowing that we'll be there sharing Sunday morning with you guys, and so much more. It's not just about Sunday morning. It's about sharing life together in that community, being together and being a part of each other's lives. That, to me, is how you can make discipleship work. And Jesus told us to go and make disciples of all nations, teaching them to obey everything he commanded them, and baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And as I've studied that, looked at that, and tried to live that out, I've come to realize one important thing. That happens in relationship. You know, that's what Jesus did. He was spending his whole life, basically, during those 3 years of ministry with the disciples to train them up, share, and really teach them what it means to make disciples. And that model, I believe, is what we're supposed to be doing today. So church, especially small country churches, which I'm excited to be part of again, that's what we have to be about, right? The relationship, being involved in each other's lives, and sharing how God is using his word to grow us, and when he shares things with us, when his word is made real in our lives, and we are convicted of things, I don't believe it's ever just for us, right? We are meant to share that, to spread that, bring that truth into the lives of others. The only way we can do that is if we're actually in relationship. You know, an hour on Sunday morning is not enough to be able to do what Jesus did. Jesus didn't just spend an hour on Sunday morning with his disciples. He was there together with them 95% of the time, not more. So I am looking forward to being able to do that, to be involved in your lives, to be present, to have you over, to have fellowship time in homes. Of course, with the COVID stuff, that's going to make a challenge to all that. But I'm excited to try to work through that challenge with you guys and re-engage, again, relationally, for the purpose of glorifying God and growing together so we can make disciples and have an impact in that community. So looking forward to the relationships that are going to restart and that we can enjoy once again. And so, see you in 2 weeks, August 2nd. We're excited for that date. See you then.
In the email that Micah sent this video with, he said, "I forgot to give an update on our house sale, though, so if anyone asks, we are doing great. Things are moving along wonderfully, and God is blessing every step. We have a couple more items to take care of for the repair addendum, which should be done this week. Overall, we should get more out of the house than I dared to hope 3 weeks ago. God is good." So thank you for that. And now we have our call to worship, which this Sunday is from 2 Chronicles chapter 6, verses 11 through 16. Do you want to read with me, or do you want me just to read it?
Read
with me. Okay, join me in reading. "And there I have set the ark, in which is the covenant of the Lord that he made with the people of Israel. Then Solomon stood before the altar of the Lord in the presence of all the assembly of Israel and spread out his hands. Solomon had made a bronze platform, 5 cubits long, 5 cubits wide, and 3 cubits high, and had set it in the court, and he stood on it. Then he knelt on his knees in the presence of all the assembly of Israel, and spread out his hands toward heaven. He said, O Lord God of Israel, there is no God like you, in heaven or on earth, keeping covenant and showing steadfast love to your servants who walk before you with all their heart, who have kept with your servant David, my father, what you declared to him. You spoke with your mouth, and with your hand have fulfilled it this day. Now therefore, O Lord God of Israel, keep for your servant David, my father, what you have promised him, saying, you shall not lack a man to sit before me on the throne of Israel, if only your sons pay close attention to their way, to walk in my law as you have walked before me." That's not the passage that it was supposed to be. In which case, the mistake is probably mine, because I typed that.
Well, you don't have to say that. 1:7, 12:15.
So let me find the correct one. 2 Chronicles. 7, I wrote down 6, that's the mistake I made. There we go, 2 Chronicles 7, 11 through 16. "Thus Solomon finished the house of the Lord in the king's house. All that Solomon had planned to do in the house of the Lord and in his own house, he successfully accomplished. Then the Lord appeared to Solomon in the night and said to him, I have heard your prayer and have chosen this place for myself as a house of sacrifice. When I shut up the heavens so that there is no rain, or command the locust to devour the land, or send pestilence among my people, if my people who are called by my name humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land. Now my eyes will be open and my ears attentive to the prayer that is made in this place. For now I have chosen and consecrated this house that my name may be there forever. My eyes and my heart will be there for all time." This was something that God said at the time of the dedication of the temple. And for the people of Israel, that temple was going to be where God's presence was. That's where they would make their pilgrimages to. That's where they would pray towards, because that's where God's presence was. That same God is here today, but now his presence is not in the physical temple in Jerusalem. It's in our hearts and minds through his Holy Spirit. And that same kind of concern that he had for the people of Israel, he has for us. And he asks us to humble ourselves and pray and seek his face. And when we do that, he will hear our prayers and he will give us his blessing. That doesn't necessarily mean we have the same kinds of promises that he made to the people of Israel, but he does promise to hear our prayers and to be with us today. So, Nathan, can you lead us in worship, please?
If you would stand with me and join the song. Back in 2 Chronicles 6, there's the verse that says, O Lord, God of Israel, there is no God like you, heaven nor on earth. And from that, let us sing, You are God alone.
Mountains shake and crumble. So let's go to prayer this morning. Just a couple things. You have your prayer list. It's in your bulletin. One of the things, it's great to see Pat Pike here. Good to see you're on the way to recovery. That's awesome. Been there, done that. It's always good to be on the uphill, moving up. So great to see you here. One thing that if you didn't notice, and if you wish to after the service, you can see some of Pastor Bill Page's handiwork out in the parking lot. We did drive the old truck that he was working on. So it's good. Derby and I had a conversation, and it's interesting that God gave him the talent to restore cars, but he gave him the better talent to restore souls. Yeah, pretty amazing. Anyway, so we got some other things on here. Barbara McClinigan has a friend, Yvonne, that's had three surgeries and she's not doing well. She is a believer, but let's pray for her that she can be on that uphill transition that we wish for everybody that has to go through surgeries and some type of recovery. So let's pray at this time. Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you for the amazing opportunity that you have blessed each one of us at different times in our lives of just needing that extra encouragement, that extra help to get through a surgery, to get through something that is causing us some stress, whatever that may be. We pray for Yvonne that you will just strengthen her, encourage her, and give her that strength that she needs. We thank you for Pastor Bill. We thank you for Pat and for the other people on the list that have needs that you can address. You will talk to their hearts because that's the one thing that you do. You actually talk to each one of us individually, and we as a group right now are praying for each individual that needs that encouragement, that you will just help them to see what you have planned for their life. We ask this in your name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
We're going to try this microphone again. We think we figured out what the problem was the last couple of weeks, so hopefully it will work okay today. For those of you who don't know me well, this shirt I'm wearing is in honor of our new grandson, our first grandchild. We would covet your prayers for him. He still has some problems, but he is gaining weight, so things are looking better than they were for a while. And now to the message for this morning. I have a bachelor's degree and a master's degree, so I'm considered to be an educated person. In school, I got pretty good grades, not great, but pretty good. But you know, I've only once in my life ever been asked, what grades did I get in school? And that's when I was filling out a job application for a federal government job, which wanted you to list every class you had taken and the grade for each of those classes. And that was just part of this huge application form, which got to be so much of a pain that I gave up and I didn't even apply for the job. Now, I'm an educated person. I bring this up not to pat myself on the back or to make myself look good, but there's a point to it. That in our society, knowledge, education, intellect, those are all considered important things. But for God, those are not important things. God doesn't care how much education we have. He doesn't care how great our intellect is. Because knowledge might be useful, is useful for many things, but wisdom, God's wisdom, that's what's essential. Not our education, not our knowledge, not our intellect. God's not impressed by all that stuff. Why? Because he made all of this. He knows everything. So when you compare somebody who knows literally everything, down to the number of hairs on your head, or lack of hair on your head is my case, compared with how much we know, our knowledge is vanishingly small. But God is impressed with wisdom. And that's the passage we want to look at in James chapter 3, verses 13 through 18. James looks some more at wisdom. In this passage, he pokes his finger at people who see themselves as spiritually wise and makes the point that true wisdom is shown by a humble life. True wisdom is shown by a humble life. Let's read the passage. James chapter 3, verses 13 to 18. Who is wise and understanding among you? Let him show it by his good life, by deeds done in the humility that comes from wisdom. But if you harbor bitter envy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not boast about it or deny the truth. Such wisdom does not come down from heaven, but is earthly, unspiritual, of the devil. For where you have envy and selfish ambition, there you find disorder and every evil practice. But the wisdom that comes from heaven is first of all pure, then peace-loving, considerate, submissive, full of mercy and good fruit, impartial and sincere. Peacemakers who sow in peace raise a harvest of righteousness. Back in James chapter 1, verse 5, James told us to ask God for wisdom. So now he's going to talk a little more about what does that wisdom look like when God gives it to you. Well, if you want to establish a reputation for wisdom, like the people he was addressing in this letter, apparently there were some in the churches he was talking to who did think of themselves as spiritually wise. But he was pointing out to them, if you are, then you will show it. Because wisdom has to be shown. Wisdom just contained up here alone is nothing. It has to be shown by your actions, by your way of life, by, as the King James puts it, your conversation, which meant a lot more than just your talking. It meant the whole way of your life. Wisdom is not about how much we know. Wisdom is understanding what God wants us to do, knowing how to do it, and then doing it. Faith without works is dead. Wisdom without action is dead. Sometimes we learn mostly from experience. I'd like to read you some quotes from some children who've learned from experience. Never trust a dog to watch your food. When your dad is mad and asks you, "Do I look stupid?" don't answer him. Never tell your mom that her diet is not working. Never try to baptize a cat. Now, these children learn some important life lessons from experience. And you can guess what that experience looked like at the time. But we have the same kind of thing in terms of learning God's wisdom, learning spiritual wisdom. Sometimes we get it from bitter experience, when we don't do what God wants, when we sin. And hopefully we do learn from that. I know there are some important lessons in my life that I only learned after I did things wrong, and then realize from the consequences of that, I don't want to do that again. I want to do it the way God says. It helps to learn from experience, but hopefully we don't have to just learn from experience. Somebody has said that wisdom is the quality that keeps you from getting into situations where you need it. Wisdom is the quality that keeps you from getting into situations where you need it. And it helps to learn wisdom from others too, from their experience, because someone else said, a wise man learns from the mistakes of others because nobody lives long enough to make them all himself. So learning wisdom can come from others, from your own experience, but primarily it comes from God himself and from his word. Notice that James says, let him show it by his good life, by deeds done in the humility that comes from wisdom. Humility is part of wisdom. And they're tied together because humility is really recognizing who God is and where you are in relation to him. When you fully understand how much greater God is than you are, then you can start to have real humility. Proverbs 9, verse 10, famous verse about wisdom. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. When you understand how awesome God truly is, there should be a little bit of fear there, because God has the power to throw us into hell if we don't obey him. That's a much greater fear there than there is for somebody who can just hurt you or kill you. Because that only lasts for a short time, but hell is for eternity. So the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. When you really understand who God is, that's when you start getting wisdom. Now, humility, or sometimes it's translated as meekness. It's a hard word to translate because in English, especially meekness, sounds a little bit like a wimp. The Greek word implies an active attitude of deliberate acceptance and is the opposite of self-assertiveness and self-interest. It's neither let up too high or cast down too low, because it's not really occupied with self at all. It's focused on God. And it is strength under control. Jesus. You hear the phrase, gentle Jesus, meek and mild, which is true, but it gives a false impression a lot of times when we think of that as being human terms, you know, cringing, mild. It's not Jesus. He was not in any way, shape, or form a wimp. I mean, after all, here's a man who took a whip, went into the temple, grabbed the tables of the money changers, threw them over, and then drove those people out with that whip. That's not the action of a wimp. Jesus was meek and mild, but he had so much strength available, but he kept it under control. So when Jesus was faced with sinners who, looking for repentance, he was gentle with them. He did not crush them or castigate them for their sin. He told them just to repent, and he lifted them up. But when he was faced with the Pharisees, who should have known better, and they needed a sharp reminder about their responsibilities before God, Jesus gave them stinging rebukes. He called them whitewashed tombs. That, again, is not the way a wimp talks. When faced with the greedy swindlers in the temple, Jesus got out a whip. But he kept it under control, that strength. And humility doesn't mean weakness. It means strength under control. It means understanding who God is and where you fit in with him. Jesus also recognized that faith and wisdom and humility go together. In Matthew 7, verse 24, "Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock." Wisdom must be shown. And there are people who lack this kind of humility and think that they are wise in their own eyes, and very often those people tend to be arrogant, such as the following person. A long time ago in American history, there was a squad of soldiers who were trying to move a heavy piece of timber. And there was a corporal there who was in charge of this group, and he thought he knew it all, so his job was not to be involved in helping, it was to tell the others what to do. And that's what he was doing. Problem was, that piece of wood, that big timber, was a little too heavy for those men to actually move. Well, a man on horseback came riding by, saw the situation and stopped, and looked at the corporal and said, "Why don't you help them?" "Me? I'm a corporal," was his response. So the man on horseback climbed off his horse, walked over, helped the men, and with the additional help, they were able to move that big piece of timber. The stranger then got back on his horse, talked to the corporal. "The next time you have a piece of timber for your men to handle, corporal, send for the commander in chief." Because that man was George Washington. The corporal, thinking he was wise because he could tell everybody what to do, had no humility. George Washington had the humility to get down off his horse and actually do something useful. James goes on to talk about the wrong kind of wisdom, earthly wisdom. Talks about bitter envy and selfish ambition. The word envy literally meant heat. It's a very strong emotion. It's that desire for what others have that you don't have. And selfish ambition comes from a word meaning a hireling, somebody you hired, and kind of changed then into meaning seeking to win followers. So it was a term that was used about people who had a cause or something and were trying to win everybody to their side. So notice their side is very self-seeking here, selfish ambition. And many times these people have this zeal for the cause and they want to get everybody involved in it. But if they don't recognize their own selfish motives or the possible evil that is coming from them, they can really destroy the cause they're trying to represent. There's a man named Paul Hill who was so opposed to abortion that he began killing doctors who worked in abortion clinics. His zeal for the cause was there, but his motives were not right, and his actions then, because his motives were not right, showed up as evil. Now, at best, this kind of wisdom, earthly or human wisdom, is just common sense, hopefully. But ultimately, this kind of wisdom comes from hell. And the result is disorder, confusion, quarrels. Very often this is where church splits happen. when worldly wisdom comes in and God's wisdom goes away. Luke chapter 21 verse 9 says, "When you hear of wars and revolutions, do not be frightened. These things must happen first, but the end will not come right away." That word revolutions is the same word disorders in this passage. So the result sometimes of this selfish ambition and bitter envy results in revolutions, fights, wars. And sometimes Christians fall into this trap of worldly, earthly wisdom. On August 3, 1996, a man named Melvin Hitchens sat on his front porch reading the Bible. Then he put down his Bible, went back inside his house, got a .45 caliber revolver, went over to his neighbor's house, shot the woman and killed her, shot the man and wounded him. Read the Bible, went out and murdered one person and tried to murder another. The neighbors and family members all said that these two families had had a bitter quarrel for years over the care of their yards and the cleanliness of their gutters. This man, Melvin Hitchens, had been looking at the source of God's wisdom, but totally ignored it, and went back to his own selfish motives, his own jealous ambition, his own bitter envy, and decided he was going to stop this quarrel once and for all by killing his neighbors. That's not heavenly wisdom. That's the extreme worldly wisdom. James then talks about world or heavenly wisdom. And he says that it's a gift from God because the wisdom comes from heaven. And you don't get it primarily by talking with people or by acquiring knowledge of the world, because you can't really get this kind of wisdom apart from God. In James chapter 1, verse 5, as I mentioned earlier, "If any of you lacks wisdom, he should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to him." And Ecclesiastes chapter 2, verse 26 also picks up on this idea. "To the man who pleases him, God gives wisdom, knowledge, and happiness. But to the sinner, he gives the task of gathering and storing up wealth to hand it over to the one who pleases God." I love, too, there that it pairs wisdom, knowledge, and happiness as coming from God. The American nation is known for its relentless pursuit of happiness. The trouble is, happiness comes from God. And most people who are pursuing happiness have God nowhere in the picture, and so they never find it. Wisdom comes from God. Then James describes, okay, what does this wisdom look like? Well, he says, first of all, it's pure. This is not just moral purity, which is often what we think of when we see the word pure, but it is the absence of sinful attitudes or motives. When something is adulterated, it has the wrong stuff mixed in with the right stuff. Pure means it's all of the same thing. So God's wisdom is pure when all of it comes from God himself, when we don't add in our own little bits to it. How do we get this wisdom, this pure wisdom? 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 22 tells us, "Now that you have purified yourselves," and how do you do that, you ask? "By obeying the truth, so that you have sincere love for your brothers. Love one another deeply from the heart." You purify yourselves by obeying the truth that you already know that God has given you. So first of all, heavenly wisdom is pure. Secondly, it is peace-loving. This kind of wisdom, it's not competitive, it's not selfish. It seeks to bring people together rather than tear them apart. Romans chapter 12, verse 18 says, "If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone." Peace is not always easy, and sometimes it doesn't totally depend on you. There are two sides in a quarrel, and if you are wanting peace and the other does not want peace at all, it's not going to happen. But seeking peace is an important thing. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 14 shows us that this kind of peace is not just something simple and easy, because it says, make every effort to live in peace with all men and be holy. Peace takes effort. It takes hard work sometimes. But God's wisdom follows peace. Now, there is the caveat that there are times when peace cannot be had because we cannot compromise the important things of our faith. But when your motive is seeking peace as far as possible, that's where heavenly wisdom leads us to. Then it says that wisdom is considerate or gentle. This means that it's fair, it's moderate, it doesn't take extremes, it doesn't always insist on the letter of the law, it considers others, and it looks at the facts of the case reasonably and humanely. Considerate, and then submissive. Submissive means being ready to obey, being ready to be persuaded. It's the opposite of obstinacy. Obstinacy says, I know my position, it's right, and nothing will change my mind. Submissive means it's willing to listen. Doesn't mean it has to always accept what it's told, but it's willing at least to listen. And then wisdom is full of mercy. Heavenly wisdom is always outward looking. It's looking to help others. It's not focused on yourself. It's willing to forgive others. Because God's wisdom is like God himself. And Micah 7:18 talks about this. Who is a God like you who pardons sin and forgives the transgression of the remnant of his inheritance? You do not stay angry forever, but delight to show mercy. God is a merciful God, therefore he wants us to be merciful also. And finally it says that wisdom results in good fruit. Colossians 1:10. And we pray this in order that you may live a life worthy of the Lord and may please him in every way, bearing fruit in every good work. In other words, wisdom is to be shown in action, and those actions should bear fruit. Adds a couple more things about wisdom. It's impartial, non-judgmental, non-discriminating, without suspicion, free from judging others without reason. And finally, sincere, being without hypocrisy. Sometimes when we go into situations, we go into them with those selfish motives, and we pretend we don't have those. We pretend to be good, but inside there's those motives that are not good. God's wisdom says, no, pure motives, be without hypocrisy. And James concludes by saying that peacemakers who sow in peace raise a harvest of righteousness. Well, what does all this mean in our daily lives? Being a wise person in God's eyes is not about having a lot of knowledge. It's about living the way God wants us to. So its primary application comes when we make decisions. And that's where wisdom has to come to bear, on our decisions. Now, of course, there are some decisions that don't require a lot of wisdom. How many of you were very concerned about what color socks you wore this morning? No. Laura, I'll have to talk to you later. What color socks? Not important. You don't need to bring a whole lot of heavenly wisdom to bear on that decision. Of course, you can make it easy for yourself like I do. All my socks are black, so I just grab one. It's more important in larger decisions than that kind of little nitpicking thing. The Bible never tells us that there's only one right choice or one correct path in life. There is no center of God's will kind of thing where you have to find exactly what things God wants you to do. God gives us choices, and he tells us to use the wisdom he gives us in making decisions about those choices. There's not necessarily only one person that you marry. Once you marry them, there should be only that one, but that's another situation. There's not necessarily only one job you should be looking for. There's a variety of things that you could do that God will bless you in when you're using wisdom in that decision. God gives us something up here, and he doesn't ever say in the scripture, take that out and throw it away. He says, use it, but use it in a godly way. Make your decisions with wisdom. The will of God in the Bible, especially in the New Testament, is almost always about behavior, not so much about making decisions. 1 Thessalonians 5:16 to 18, be joyful always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. God's will is connected with being joyful, praying, giving thanks. And 1 Thessalonians 4:3, it is God's will that you should be sanctified, that you should avoid sexual immorality. So most of the time when we see God's will in the New Testament, it's telling us how to behave, how to live, what kind of values to have, not about whether you should marry this person, take that job, go to that school, those kinds of things. So when we are making decisions, on the negative side, our decisions should not revolve around envy or selfish ambition or choosing sides. In other words, it's not about our own selfish motives. It's about looking for what God would have us do based on what we've learned in his word. Positively, it's about making sure that our motives are pure, that we are seeking peace, that we are considering the needs of others, that we are obedient to God and to the authorities he set up, that have mercy and fruitfulness and impartiality and sincerity. This kind of wisdom doesn't start with its mind made up and then try to have scripture crown that decision ahead of time. God wants us to have an open mind as we come to his word and as we come to making decisions, keeping this idea of heavenly wisdom and the things it talks about here as we make those decisions. And that, when we're using that kind of wisdom, should result in peace and a harvest of righteousness. And it doesn't happen automatically. It requires hard work. But God wants us to have this kind of wisdom. So my challenge for you for this week is to look at one specific type of decision. I chose this because it's very convicting to me. And that is, what are you going to use your free time for this week? Can you apply God's wisdom to how you decide and what you decide on to do with your free time, assuming you have some, which I think all of us do, but maybe not. And so look at that. Okay, is this activity that I think I want to do, how do these things of God's wisdom fit into it? Are there issues of purity involved? Will the activity bring about peace, or will it cause trouble and friction between people? In doing this, am I considering the needs of others? Is there an issue of obedience here? Will I be showing mercy through this activity? Will it be fruitful or just a waste of time? Am I being impartial in making this choice? Am I being sincere about it, or is there a little bit of hypocrisy involved? Now, not all of these categories fit to every decision. But this week, as you're considering how you're going to use your free time, try and look seriously at these kinds of things as you're making that decision. Let's close in prayer. Father, thank you for promising to give us wisdom so that we can live our lives in ways that are pleasing to you. Help us this week as we make decisions to remember to look for the evidence of your wisdom and to apply that wisdom to the choices we make. We ask your blessing on us through this week. In Jesus' name, amen.
If you would like to stand as we close in song.
Revelation 7, where the angels are before God in the throne room. But join me. And the angel said, Amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen.